Good morning, everyone. It's so good to see you here, and it's good to know that we have folks that are on the Facebook Live, and we hope that you're greeting one another even now. And if you're a guest, we hope that you will send us an email, let us know that you are with us today. We hope that those of you who watch later on our live streaming on our website, or who are watching on YouTube at any other time, we're hoping to know that you are a part of us even now. So with that said, we are speeding through our liturgical calendar right now. We are here at the end of the Epiphany season. Today is Transfiguration Sunday, and it is the last Sunday of Epiphany, and we will have Ash Wednesday coming up, of course, this Wednesday. And we are going to be doing things a little differently this year. So if you would like to have ashes sprinkled on you, you need to come between 7 and 8 a.m. on Wednesday morning under the portico in the back of the church. You can come from noon to 1, or you can come from 5 to 6. And when you pull up, you will receive ashes. And the service, the Ash Wednesday service, will be downloaded and will be ready for you. We call it dropped. In other words, it will be out for you to see starting early Wednesday morning. And so that will be a very short meditative service that you can couple with your receiving of the ashes. And you can do it at your own convenience and at any time during the day as part of your meditation. This service for Ash Wednesday is going to be more of a meditation, less of a big regular worship service. So hope that you will want to be a part of that. Also want to hope that Wednesdays become an important day for you during Lent. Because starting the Wednesday after Ash Wednesday and moving for 5 consecutive Wednesdays, we are going to be having a special Lenten program on Zoom. So you can just come on to the Zoom meeting on any of those Wednesday nights. And the title of our study this year is, What's the Difference? And we want to learn a little bit more about what's the difference in our world in several different places. And we hope that you will want to be a part of it. One of the things that we always say at Lent is that it's not just a time to give something up, because we have given up a lot in the last year, but to take something on. And we take this time on to focus, to prepare, and to give ourselves an opportunity to really know that we are preparing for this wondrous Easter season that will be coming up in early April. Actually, Easter Sunday is April 4th. So everything is moving right along, and we hope that you'll want to be a part of that. Today is also Scout Sunday, and we want to welcome any scouts that are on worshiping with us today. We hope that you are there. I hope you'll greet and say, hey, I'm a Boy Scout, or I'm a Cub Scout, or I'm a wolf or a bear. Just let us know who you are so that we can celebrate with you today. We during our children's time, we're going to be doing a recognition of scouting. And we believe it's an important part of the ministry of this church that we sponsor these different groups. We have the BSA boys, BSA girls, and we have the Cub Scout pack, which is both boys and girls now. So it's lots of good things that are happening with that. So I hope that you will prepare for that as well. Is there a meeting today for the kick? Is today kick? No, today is not kick. Okay, I thought I was mistaken. I just wanted to check with you. So that's next week, did you say? Okay, yeah, so kick will be next Sunday. So just wanted to let you know that as well. So have a great Valentine's Day today, and celebrate as you're able in a COVID fashion, as we've been learning how to do. So let us now prepare for our worship by standing, if you are here and able. And if you'd like to stand at home, you may. And we will have our call to worship. Gathering in this sacred place, we anticipate new wonders.
Wherever two or three are gathered to worship, God is present.
Open our eyes to witness the love and wondrous truth revealed even this day.
May our hearts be open to all the wonders of the way of Christ.
Thank you. confession. O God, it is one thing to have a high experience, a mountaintop experience, with Jesus up in the clouds where everything is brilliant. But we confess that the allure of this experience can keep us from what our call is, to accompany Jesus to the cross, to take up our crosses, to die in order to live, to be last in order to be first, to refuse the invitation to turn away from God's way. We pray that we may be the church, and we will listen to God's Son. Love God and do the right thing, for Christ brings forgiveness. Amen. Our first scripture lesson this morning is from 2 Corinthians 4, verses 3 through 6. Hear these words. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. And through this scripture, God is still speaking, and we are listening.
That probably sounded good at home.
Sorry about that.
That's okay. We are now going to go into our time of our children's time, and we hope that the children will be a part of this. But in the past, in every February 2nd, Sunday in February, we usually have a full set of steps right here because we have all of our Cub Scouts and many of our Boy Scouts who are here, and they usually take part in the service. So not having you here in person today is one of those deprivations that we once again have in this season of COVID, but we want to continue to recognize you. And so what we're going to do next is allow each of the groups, first of all our Scout Pack, our Cub Scout Pack, and then our BSA boys leader, and then our BSA girls leader to share in a brief video presentation for you. So stand back and let us get everything set up.
Hey there, Elon UCC. Thank you guys so much for your support both in 2020, 2021, and always. It's been great for our family being part of the Elon UCC Pac 51 Scout family these last 4 or 5 years. And here's to many more. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Elon Community Church, for supporting the Lion Scouts. And here's something we like to do, the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can you show them you love them, Hart?
From the Gregory family, thank you very much for all the support of PAC and Troop and Ship 51. Scouting has been a big part of our life, particularly PAC 51. I think between the four of us, we've been involved in the PAC a total of about 20 years, if you add it all up.
It's been fantastic to be a parent and a den leader for PAC 51, and it's been especially wonderful to get to do it in our home church, in Elon Community Church. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Nathan Mitchell, and we're thankful
that you have continued to sponsor Troop 51. We currently have 22 scouts ranging from ages 12 to 18. Thank you for all your support. And 3, 2, 1.
Thank you for sponsoring us.
Hi, my name is Carol Plaster. I'm the Scoutmaster for Troop 6051, which is a BSA troop for girls that meets in Elon. I just wanted to express my gratitude to Elon Community Church for your support of the scouting program. It has been a real blessing for these girls to have opportunities to get together in person in safe ways and be outdoors and be learning skills and having a good time fellowshipping together, especially because they haven't been able to go to school this year and be around their friends. So despite the challenges of the pandemic, we've done some really neat things. Before the pandemic hit, we were able to go snow skiing. Afterwards, we had backyard campouts where we zoomed in and showed each other what we had prepared for dinner. Some of our scouts participated in the encampment program at Cherokee Scout Reservation this summer, which was just a one-day event, and we also had some of our scouts serving as staff members for that. In the fall, we went on a couple of camping trips to scout camps in the region, and just recently came back from a trip to the mountains where we were had a surprise snowstorm while we were preparing dinner. So again, I just wanted to thank you for your support, and we look forward to hopefully being with you next year on Scout Sunday.
This is usually when the scouts would stand and do their scout law, and we are going to do it on behalf of them today.
We have a couple in the back, they probably could participate.
I hope you remember the scout law, that's
if
right.
If you know the scout law.
That's right. The scout law is a guiding light to millions of youngsters and adults throughout the world today. But the principles of the law have been brought to us from ancient days. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor.
A scout is trustworthy.
He who is faithful in a very little is faithful also in much. And he who is dishonest in very little is dishonest also in much.
A scout is loyal.
You shall not take vengeance or bear any grudge against any of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself.
A scout is helpful.
Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. That comes from Romans. But hear these words from Psalm. Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers and sisters dwell in unity.
A scout is friendly.
Leave no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear.
A scout is courteous.
A righteous person knows the needs of their animals, but the mercy of the wicked is cruel.
A scout is kind.
Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may be well with you and you may live long on the earth.
A scout is obedient.
A glad heart makes a cheerful countenance, but by sorrow of heart of the spirit is broken. The mind of the one who has understanding seeks knowledge, but the mouths of fools feed on folly. All the days of the afflicted are evil, but a cheerful heart has a continual feast.
A scout is cheerful.
Go to the ant, O sluggard. Consider her ways and be wise. Without having any chief, officer, or ruler, she prepares her food in summer and gathers her sustenance in harvest.
A scout is thrifty.
Be strong and of good courage. Do not fear or be in dread of them, for it is in the Lord your God who goes with you. God will not fail you or forsake you.
A scout is brave.
Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? Those who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not lift up their souls to what is false, and do not swear deceitfully, they will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from the God of their salvation.
A scout is clean.
And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment.
A scout is reverent. He and she is reverent towards God. He and she is faithful in his or her religious duties and respects the convictions of others in matters of custom and religion.
Amen. This is a time to go back to Scripture, our gospel lesson. We just read lots of Scriptures, but this one we skip way ahead from in the Gospel of Mark. We're going to that place known as the story of the Transfiguration, and it is Mark 9, verses 2 through 9. And as you hear this being read, just know that this is the bookend, if you will, of this Epiphany season. We open Epiphany with the baptism of Jesus, and now we have the transfiguration of Jesus. So hear these words as I read from the Gospel of Mark. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up to a high mountain apart by themselves. And Jesus was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were all terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my Son, the Beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one was with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. Thus ends our gospel lesson for this morning. Let us be in prayer. Now, Lord, let the words of my mouth, meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, there's a couple things we can do in Facebook Live that we don't usually do when everyone is together. That first hymn today was a real new experience for some and others, because that's usually been a choir hymn, and so for you all to be able to help lead us through that was really wonderful. Thank you for that today. And that sense of glory, that sense of light shining was a beautiful experience. Also, this is always an interesting Sunday. This is always Scout. The second Sunday in February is always Scout Sunday, but it's not always Transfiguration Sunday. So we do different things at different times. And so each of us understands that we are not in the earliest we can be in Lent, but we are definitely in an earlier cycle for Easter. So take that, groundhog. Just because you think it's going to be a longer winter, we know with an early Easter, we stand a chance of having a good early spring. So sorry about that. I just had to bring that up. So I want you to see and hear the story today. And many times we've read in the Old Testament from the story about how Elijah is taken up into the sky. This chariot of fire comes and brings him to a new place. We didn't read that today because there was something about the Corinthians text that really grabbed me today in thinking about what this all means, this light and glory. And just the idea of the story itself, it's a common thing for us to say you can't always stay at the mountaintop. That's not something that's new. But what's interesting is that so often we don't really look at the story and try to understand it. And there's a good reason for that. I'm not sure we're meant to understand it. I think we're meant sometimes to experience things, not always be able to rip them apart or tear them apart or be able to look at them from all their pieces. One might say, why in the world was a story like this needing to be there anyway? And why does Moses and Elijah play such an important role? And it's interesting, if you think about it, all three of them had experiences in which they were with God in very unexplainable ways. Because even though we didn't read that story as well, Moses, of course, is called by God from the burning bush. That light, that fire that never went away in a bush that was never consumed by the fire, and yet this fire was there. How do you explain that? You can't. When Elijah is taken up into the sky, how do you explain that? You can't. And just even now, Jesus is transfigured before them. And you know that word transfigured often is utilized. I'm wondering at times if we've ever even talked about it. To be transfigured is exactly the opposite of being transformed. And I bet many of us usually think when we think of the word transfigured that that Jesus was somehow transformed into something else. No, to be transfigured means that he was actually just shown in a miraculous way who he already was. There is no changing Jesus at this point except his outer self. But transformation is when we literally change on the inside. I want you to think about that as we go through the rest of our time together. Because in this light and glory, in this sense of the season of light coming to a close, this kind of light, for some of us, is really, really important. And many times we need it terribly. But some would say, well, I'm not really into all that spiritual stuff. I want to have stuff I can do. I want to be told how to live my life. I want to be told how to act. And that's enough for me. And what's interesting in this story and in Paul's letter to the Corinthians in that second letter, we see this constant sense of people trying to figure out who they are because of Jesus. And the question is, in this midst of light and glory and all of this that is being shown upon us, what does it mean to be who we are? How do we name that, and how do we say, this is who I am? Now, Paul would say, I proclaim Christ. I don't proclaim myself. That doesn't go against any kind of notion of not the understanding of self. What it says is that my first and most important way of thinking of myself is to know that I am in Christ. And when we do that and acknowledge that, we now have an ordering of who we are. We then see our skills, we see our abilities, we see the ways that we will express ourselves now defined in that category. But Paul would also say, for some, the gospel is veiled. And he would say, those are those who are missing the point. Because somehow the light and the glory of the mountaintop is a defining moment that allows us to see, like the disciples, that we're really terrified, that we're really uncertain of what it all means, that we receive this and we think we've got it all figured out. No, we don't have it all figured out. But instead, we don't try to hold on. We try to say, where do we go from here? And there's no accident that even in this reading, that the last words of this scripture reading that we shared are about Jesus going down the mountain. And I've always thought about that. That means that one day Jesus said to these disciples, let's go mountain climbing. You know, we never talk about that. All of a sudden they just happened to be at this mountaintop. Takes a while to get to a mountaintop. Takes a little bit of work and a little bit of effort. And it takes a sense of dedication. But that didn't seem important. What seemed important was that they now had an understanding of what was going to take place afterwards. Because you see in Mark, I think I told you when we were preaching from Matthew, that the climax in Matthew got moved. It got moved to that Matthew 25, those three wondrous stories, those three wondrous parables that Jesus shares, culminating in the one where Jesus talks to the sheep and the goats. Remember the splitting up of the sheep and the goats, and says, you know, because you fed me, because you clothed me, because you were there with me when I was imprisoned, when you did all of these things, even to the least of these, you've done it to me. That was that climax. But in Mark, this is the climax. This is the moment. This is the pinnacle, which then leads then from here on out, the trip to Jerusalem and the crucifixion that Jesus will go through, the death that he will take, that he will go through and experience, and reminding us that this light and glory, we might not ever completely figure it out, but we know that it has a cost. And that cost means for us giving of ourselves. So we see Jesus defining us first. We see giving of ourselves. How does that translate into a world today? When it seems that what we hear most about is how I can be the best, how I can find that victory, how I can be that person that everybody looks to. Selfishness, greed, all of those things that we've talked about, that we sometimes want to deny, that we really want to push under the rug, we kind of say, no, that's not us. We want to have a faith, but we really don't want to change. We want to believe and we want to be loved, and we actually want to love, well, at least we want to love those who we want to love. But we really don't necessarily want to change. Jesus' transfiguration reminds us that Jesus was more than just a healer and more than just one who would come and expel spirits, unclean spirits. That Jesus was even more than a teacher. Jesus was showing us a way and bringing to us something very different. So if Epiphany has meant anything to us, it has now opened our eyes, and I pray opened our hearts and our ears to hear these words. To know that we, in the midst of all that we face, have an identity and have the ability to show forth a light and to live in that light. But that light is going to demand things of us, because when we look at those who are around us, it means that we may too have to take up our cross. And if you haven't figured it out yet, crosses are not easy to carry. And dying is not one of those things that we really like to go through. We need to understand that when we hear and when we see, that means we can't unsee and unhear. That means we have to face the challenges that come at the bottom of the mountain, that take us to a place where we have to follow the demands of Christ and not of our convenience, not of those things that allow us to have, well, have life be only easy for us. In this Black History Month, we're reminded so often that there are people in our lives and people in our world who have not had easy lives. When we think about that chariot who picked up Elijah, and we sing this wondrous spiritual, "Swing Low, Sweet Chariot," in just a few moments, it is about a code language when things couldn't be said openly. And now we live in a world where we seem to have a lot of code language as well. It seems that there are languages of conspiracy, languages of fear, languages of doubt, languages that allow us only to live with a sense of uncertainty and even chaos at times. And some of us can say, maybe we don't understand that either. But we seem to long, or we seem to be drawn to all of those things that cause us that kind of pain, instead of looking in the light, instead of seeing that there is truth, and that the challenges that await us mean that we may, as our litany said today, may be accompanying Jesus to the cross and watching him do what he was called to do, but then going on with our life and seeing that we too have a call. As we close out this Epiphany season, this season of light and glory, this season of call, this season of understanding the costs of discipleship, of moving beyond our own selfish wants, of moving beyond those things that we sometimes want to innocently claim as that what we need to expect, instead hearing a call. "This is my son. Listen to him and follow." Amen and amen. I just want to say it is an incredible joy to be able to recognize our scouts today. And I want to thank all the scouts that helped with their short and brief videos, brief but wonderful videos. And I also want to say that we have a wondrous joy in the sense that as university has started again, we have been able to provide, this building has provided some space for students across the street. And even though we can't be here all the time that we want to be, Some of these rooms are now being used to help in rooms that they have, were too small over there for them to be able to use. We have larger rooms that they have been able to utilize. What a gift that is to be able to share our facility. What a gift it is to know. I was looking at it the other day, and I said, in a sense, the building is kind of transformed as well for the needs of the day. It holds things for us. It holds boxes downstairs waiting to be shipped to Honduras. We're trying to raise money to make sure that those things get sent off. Our building holds these wondrous cooks and meals that go on each week. In the next few weeks, there's going to be another blood drive. Lots of places haven't been able to do blood drives, but we can. We have the space to be able to do it. The sanctuary is filled with song and music from rehearsals. It is beautiful to know that we can reach out and share. And I also want to celebrate all of those people that got on the simulation game this last week. We had a pretty good sized group, and what it was about meant something when we realized that the cards are stacked against some people. And usually it's because of the color of their skin. And we learned about it in a real way. And we're going to take that and move forward. In fact, tomorrow night and Tuesday night on PBS is a special about the Black Church. I hope you'll watch it. Well, maybe we'll discuss it. It's really an important thing to understand why we are who we are. There is light and there is glory in what we see. So please take advantage of that if you have some time tomorrow night and Tuesday night to watch that on PBS. I think it starts around 8 o'clock or something like that. But we will have that on our joys and concerns. We know that there's been joys of getting phone calls, even though we can't be in person. But people in some of the nursing homes and stuff are making some progress right now. And we are so excited and so hopeful. And so we want to continue to hold those folks in our prayers. And we know that there are other concerns that we share with you, and we want you to hold them up in prayers. We know that there are probably some concerns we don't know about. And we always ask that you just help us to know, because we would love to be able to extend our prayers and our support for you. So in that vein, let us now go to God in prayer. Almighty and everlasting God, when a young child, boy and girl, can go outside and learn about nature, when they can learn to build fires and camp outside, when they learn the skills of being outdoors, when they learn the skills of working together and communicating with one another, we celebrate. When we know that there are people who are eating who may not be able to eat with the quality of food that we can provide, we're thankful. When this building houses and allows for certain things to take place, we are thankful that we have such a building to share. And when we come together, and we will come together again, O God, we will celebrate in ways that we still have yet to expect. But we are mindful of those who are still hurting. And we are thankful that everyone is waiting in line to do the vaccines and is working hard to get those appointments. We pray that you will give us the strength that we need to get through this time, that as we face the issues of the day, you will give us the strength and bravery and loyalty, kind of like those laws of the scouts, to be able to live and be Christian in all that we do. And for those concerns that rest upon our hearts, those concerns that we have shared with you now. We pray that you will be with us in this moment, that you will surround each of them and be with us as we share in silence those concerns that rest now in our hearts as we pray. And these things we share and lift up in the name and love of Jesus the Christ, who was transfigured that we might know your way. And we pray in his name, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now it is time to share our gifts of tithes and offerings. It is a time to celebrate all that we are able to do and all that we are able to be.
Let it shine, oh let it shine.
Let us pray. Gracious and heavenly God and giving God, we thank you for these gifts. Let these gifts let us shine throughout this church, this community, in this world. We thank you, O God, for all that you give. Amen.
Beautiful song. A wondrous month, allowing us to celebrate and to know. And also a season of change. For now we come into our Lenten season, and I hope that you will all take some part in some way into our Ash Wednesday, whether you're able to physically be here for Ashes, or whether you're just going to watch the meditations online, or whether you do both, we want you to be a part. It's a time of new beginning. It's a time for us to come into this season together. Let us go forth in the love and the light and the glory of our Christ, knowing that we have found the way, knowing that that way is set before us, And we are called now to live and love in that way. We go forth in God's peace in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.